Welcome back. Riders on the Norm. We got a good show this week, but first, this thing is brought to you by Get Lowered. Go to getlowered.com. They got free shipping on everything. They hooked us up with some freaking Simpson helmets, some Alpine Star boots. These guys are making this show happen. So visit them, buy some things from them, support the people that support you. So look, we got a good friend of ours, JD, on the show this week. He was kind of reluctant to let me record this conversation, but he's a ham at heart, and he couldn't resist after a few minutes. He said, all right, let's do it. So the Fizzle is, let me give you a little backstory on JD, a.k.a. the Fizzle. So he's like the old head around here. JD's probably 65, 66 now. And just a cool old freaking chopper dude from way back in the day, and he's got some good stories. But anyways, so JD used to live here in the neighborhood, and we would all hang out over at his place. There'd be 15, 20 of us, man, on a Wednesday night. It was fucking fun, like 2005, 6, 7, somewhere around there. But anyways, he moved out to the country, so on Monday, last Monday, I took a ride up there to hang out with him. I got to go check on him every once in a while. He's up there by himself. So we sat down in the garage. We had the fans going. It was hot as shit, so there's a little bit of that in the audio. There's a lot of that in the audio. But it is well worth it. The Fizzle takes you on a mindfuck journey every once in a while, and it's fun. So hang on, enjoy the ride. Let's get with JD, aka the Fizzle.
And I said, precious memories, take me back to the good old days. Let me hear my mama sing. Rock of ages, clap for me. She turned me on to Jesus.
Hey, I got a little bit over there too, man. How do you think I handle it up here? How do you think a human being could live by himself
in the cornfield?
Don't even see human beings for days at a time.
You got
Why don't I get to wave to a mailman if he happened to be out there?
You got Joe.
Who?
Joe.
I hardly ever see him, though, because he has that kind of work thing going on at times. Mm-hmm. Then he just got his knees.
Both of them, didn't he?
He's fucking cyborg now.
Oh, God.
He won't trust us anymore. We're meat bags.
Yeah?
We're meat bags. He's a fucking cyborg.
We're meat bags.
He's superior. Watch. He'll be different.
When the machines come?
Yeah. It's already happened, you know. First, the robots would take all of the jobs. Yeah. Except, will they be building the rebuild the 56 panhead? There it is.
Yeah.
Will they have that? Hell no, not for a long time. Just because of its funkiness.
So.
Now, they could assemble one. You could put them on an assembly line, and they could send a whole bunch of parts down there. But as far as, like, trying to take one, rebuild it, it's going to take them a long time. But when they get to that, the AI, the artificial intelligence robots.
Yeah.
But it will eventually happen.
Sorry. I know where we're at.
I'd be dead, like, so even hopefully my grandkids would be dead by the time they robotize that far. It's going to take a while. But it's coming. It's coming quickly.
What are you drinking on there? Is that tea?
She's talking about my grandson, you know, Anthony, growing up. She goes, well, he won't see that. I went, oh, yeah, it's already happening. Robot life. Yeah, fucking meat bags. No drug testing required. I mean, they got everything to gain from it. Nothing to lose. All the rich, you know, centers of making even more fucking money.
Yeah.
They're going to robotize.
Yeah.
$15 an hour? Take this, bitch.
Yeah. They're already doing
it. You have been replaced.
By a kiosk. They've already got. You can order a hamburger in Times Square with a button.
Fucking kiosk and robot head.
And it'll come out.
Everything.
How crazy.
Pretty soon everything. Restaurants, everything.
Yeah, I mean, you're not going. They're not going to need. You're not going to need humans.
That's right. They're just going to let us crawl off in the corner and die.
What will be our purpose, JD?
Yeah, when evolutionary's little clock stops or slows down, you see, we kill ourselves, or we just have to crawl off and let the robots come in and mop up the rest of us and kill us. Let us just go off and
God.
Die somewhere. It's a tight and soft cave. Back to the caves.
Have you seen iRobot?
Oh, yeah.
So
like, I remember reading a lot of, like, George Highland and all those sci-fi books. I can't remember. It's been so long ago. Before the LSD age even came along.
Yeah.
There was, you know, Arthur C. Clarke, Childhood Ed. Oh, yeah, I was into that. I was really a geek when I think about it.
Yeah.
At the time, I didn't know. There was no word for, maybe even before pre-nerd.
You were a square.
I didn't think so because, you know, first off, the only time you could get nailed, be it called that, is in school.
Yeah.
If you didn't give it away, you're okay.
Okay.
There, you had to be a completely different person.
Don't be telling people you're into science.
Oh,
shit.
Hell no. Besides just the maniac farm boy, country boys that live right by me that controlled the bus during my little early days of riding it, you know, back in those days.
Yeah.
They completely dominated. I mean, you weren't even slave status to a Roman if you were on that bus and you couldn't defend yourself. And this clan ruled the bus. Oh, man, but brutal. You'd be sitting there, I mean, they would shoot a paper clip out of a rubber band from the front of the bus to the back, and you swore it cracked the glass at the back of the door, but it cracked safety glass. Oh, take your eye out. And they would laugh, you know. They would play Army with 22.
Is that tea?
Yeah, you want some?
Yeah, can I make a glass?
No, you don't have to, man. It's pre-made.
Ah.
I can't, you know.
Did you hit that?
I'll hit it again. You got me in the robot.
Nice, I like it. You got me in the robots. Ah, damn it.
Shitty of a recording this is.
Oh, you just hear the fan. Everybody, you're gonna hear the fan in the background. That's all you get. Sorry.
It's kind of Arizona stuff, tea for now. But not like my mom's out there, no sun tea.
Oh, yeah.
Smoke this shit. But.
It's nice to have something, though, you know?
It kind of reminds you of something. Not a sun thing, but it's pretty much what they had going on. What's the matter?
I just don't want to bump it and lose it.
Yeah, I'll have to get a washer and shim that.
That's
shim it. It's the floor. That table, I assembled it perfectly. It's the fucking floor.
Yeah. Here, this whole thing is you. I tried to get Jeff to ride up with me.
Jeff, you?
Yeah.
Yeah, I know, he brought you to come up.
Yeah, he normally would ride with me, but he said he had to go get his hair cut and fucking... nice, that's it. Level.
I'm gonna give me a haircut today, too.
Yeah.
It's called in the head in there, my wall clippers in the drawer.
He
on
should
the
just
left.
Shave it too.
Fuck yeah, just buzz it.
That's what I do.
You can layer it.
You can layer it.
Short and really, really, really short. Especially when it's like, you know, feels like 103 up here in the summer.
Here, that's
yeah, we need some more of that.
I'll load me up one.
A little help from me friends. Well, I get some music going.
Like
a little CD player, a garage
nice.
Hookup.
Yeah.
Using part of my last phone's sound system, little speaker.
Yeah.
Just instead of playing that big system in there and cranking it, I just turn it on out here when I'm out here.
Yeah.
Play CDs. I got some formulation of just a few nice.
Have you seen the studio at the house? I don't think so.
think you were telling me about it, but I still have not been honored with seeing it. Mm. You told me, yeah, that's right. You took over that whole other room.
Yeah.
What the hell? Hey, I got room for a studio right now, too. I got a second bedroom that's wide open for something like that.
That's what I did with that.
Eventually, I will get, but what am I? You know, a bass player. So I'd have a bass amp, a bass, and I have to sit there and play with the stereo. Play the bass lines. That's about as high tech as I get, you know.
Yeah.
I'll go over, but I don't think anybody here is, you know, the last people I was picking were sometimes they might actually call me and ever find a drummer.
Right. I started playing
she's a singer.
Chicken picking.
Pipes.
Yeah. I've seen y'all. Remember?
But the whole thing fell apart now. They're not doing anything. What I'm saying is Patty, Miss Pipes.
Yeah.
She's not doing anything, and she always looks. She's a fantastic singer, especially for playing anything like that.
What did we saw y'all? What was that place called below the ground that time that y'all played down there?
Firebellies?
Yeah, Firebellies.
Oh, yeah. That was one of our few inside jobs.
That was cool.
Did you know?
Yeah.
I'll tell you what, though, about going out, because I never, you know, bluegrassed and countryed it up so much in my life. I never did, actually, until then. Rock and roll all the way. And it's interesting, no drummer. But we had gigs all the time because of it.
Yeah.
Like that. I never thought I would end up playing this down there, you know, then on the street at the street thing they got going on there three times a year.
Yeah.
They have the market and everything going on. They always had us play down there, spring and fall.
Yeah.
We're on rotation at the farmer's market down there.
Dude, that's awesome.
Meet all kinds of people. You get wet, you can freeze, you can just melt playing outside. But that's a street musician, too. But
yeah.
It was awesome doing that.
That's
played
cool.
a lot. We played churches. A lot of private parties.
Churches?
We played for church people, man. Sitting out there. They had it all set up. They were watching.
Yeah.
They didn't have the mosh pit.
No.
But they had a big front row where they actually could have jumped up and did some.
Yeah.
But they were up, toe tapping, clapping their hands. I tell you, that was probably, I'll never forget that moment. That was as good as a standing ovation. But, you know, you figure in a biker band, everybody's drunk, so.
Yeah.
You know, they're always doing that.
Yeah.
But when you get people,
church-loving
people doing it, you've done something.
Yeah.
Because I was there when there's the white Church of God people would get up and bring the black Church of God people down for like a jam.
Yeah.
You know, let them get up and let their choir take the stage.
Oh, yeah.
And oh, man, I'll tell you, this is way before Blues Brothers, but it was better than that because it was real. Oh, it was like seeing a Motown Review gospel band with the best singer singing you could ever hope to hear for. They're like the voices of angels, man.
Yeah.
All of them sisters, man, can got it.
Yeah.
They got it. And they have the male review on the drums, the bass, the keyboard. But them women, them soul sisters, gospel singers, they got the pipes, man.
What are you talking about playing?
I've never heard anything so good in my life.
This recent band that are you talking about back in the day?
With Pete and Patty and them, that was just in the last few years.
But the church thing.
Oh, that was way back.
What were y'all playing then? Because that was a biker band.
Oh, that was back. That was the FLH biker band from Northeast Ohio.
What was the band? What was the band?
What was the band?
Yeah.
The FLH band?
We're
all just country boys, but I was actually inspired by the number one biker band in the United States at the time, who happened to be from Cleveland, Ohio. See, I saw them play. And I have to give props to Blues because he's the one that started it all, biker band thing, if you ask me. Like back when the Doobie Brothers and shit were playing for the Angels, maybe.
Yeah.
Well, Blues was doing it back there, up there on the North Coast in Ohio. And
who are you talking about?
The Burnt River Band. They were called the Burnt River Band, the Cuyahoga River in Cleveland.
Okay.
Well, the river caught on fire.
Yeah.
It made national news.
Jesus Christ.
It was so polluted at the time.
Cleveland.
We got to do the flats.
Yeah, Cleveland rocks.
Stanley started him and I got to remember the original three. Red and the guy on Indian on drums. I can't remember his name. Call him Indian.
Hit that or hand it to me.
The original gangster of North America. We had that's when they were the best.
The burnt. See him out of the burnt.
Yeah, anybody that rode Harleys back in those days, you know, it was like the, especially in the earlier 70s when I first saw him play. And that's what inspired me to later, you know, find the guys to start it, something in their vein, but play a little bit more, you know, bluesy kind of, you know, George Thurgood, do more ZZ Top than they did, more rock and roll, Jay Giles, you know. We would play all kinds of different Alice Cooper and Alex Harvey band, man. We like to mix it up a little bit more than that.
So that's the stuff.
So we ended up doing a lot of gigs with them, especially for Abate, that when it first started back in Ohio, mm-hmm. We're supported by our chapter to go to the state convention, and then if you did the state convention, you always played with Burnt River because they were the headliner.
Right.
And there'd be turn all over Daytona, you know, they would go to Sturgis. They were always out there in those days, and all around out in Canada, they were touring. They went from riding their bikes in like we always did, riding our choppers in with our entourage with the vans, the old 69 Chevy vans and Chevy coming in, and the old U-Haul trucks, all this shit. And everybody, like 30 of us riding, but then they started coming in on the limousine, you know.
Oh, God.
Like a first ZZ Top video.
I'll tell you what, I'll show you a picture right now. I got it right here.
Let me see that. The Fizzle.
Yeah, and that's Stanley. That's blues from Burnt River.
Yeah.
We opened for them back in those days a lot. And, their bass player, they were just came back from Canada up a gig up there, and their bass player, they said he had a bad cheeseburger experience or something, but he didn't make it. So after playing like for 5 hours to cover the time it took them to get there, I had to jam with them because they had no bass player. So then my friends took a picture of me up there with them. That's kind of like a dream come true picture for me right there, because I always wanted to emulate, you know, they were the first, I'll give them that.
Yeah.
But then we ended up, little did I know, I'd end up all the way opening for them, and they were not so happy when they were asked to open for us, even though it never happened, because I had to stop it, because they were the number one biker band. We were supposed to be two, but man, we gave them a run, buddy, and we were in the running.
And so where were y'all playing? Did y'all play at Daytona and shit like that?
Well, that's what happened.
Yeah.
I hope this is an... I don't want him to...
Dude, just... Believe me.
Well, I know, because everybody told me what happened.
Yeah.
Because he wanted to kind of be like our working manager with us to go to Sturgis. And we said, no, we want to take our own guitar player.
Yeah.
And after that, we were bumped right all the running in for Daytona, too. Mm-hmm. But this is where I give props to the only group of people, though, who weren't in control of, like, say, the Amjam. We were in the running for that, but we used to do a lot of parties for, and I love these days, these are the golden days, too, because we used to do a lot of things up there for the HAs, you know?
Yeah.
They're always paid. They're always there and take care of it.
Mm-hmm.
We were there to do our job, and they knew it. They loved us.
What year is this?
They loved us! That was being the 70s there, through the 70s and into the 80s. It went to the FLH band, lasted like over 10 years.
Yeah.
I had to get another guitar.
That's a good run.
I only smoked out one guitar player. Well, he took himself out. But he was a veteran, too, and he re-upped. But he came back, and he almost tried. Then, God rest his soul, he's not with us no more. Suicide, really, by hanging.
God.
Hanging in the barn back in Ohio from whence we came from.
What?
There's some tough times back in then. Some boys died from bike wrecks, a lot of them in the car wrecks, a lot of them like that.
Yeah.
Three friends by suicide.
Why?
When we were in our 20s.
Why do you think that is?
One was for a woman I know. Two was just for the... he was totally, these guys were like the best guitar players I ever jammed with.
Yeah.
But they were like in a different world, like a Telsa kind of guy, like a Nikolai Telsa.
Yeah.
They're so far out there, they're like, they can't do mundane things and have jobs and work for the man and shit. They have to, they're only happy when they're high and they're playing the fucking guitar.
Yeah.
That's it. And then, of course, getting laid.
Yeah.
Afterwards. But they have no concept of the responsibility of anything in between that.
Right.
Those things, you know? Like, I had to pick them up. They all DUI'd out of driver's licenses by the time they were like 20. Not one of them had a driver's license that was valid. They all had DUIs. Yeah, they're always part. One guitar case always carried a small bar up on stage. And this is where you're getting free drinks, too, by the way. Always had a couple of bottles in there. And they kind of almost had me going, but we started getting good, you know. We started getting our shit together. I had a drummer that was hardwired drummer. He didn't get drunk at all.
Yeah.
And you had to stay with him, so I had to give up the old too many of them, you know. He'd do a shot with you before it started.
Yeah.
Then he'd be doing, he's the Gatorade kid.
Yeah.
You better be holding on your ass to keep up with him, not be drunk.
I was about to say, that's probably a smart thing to do. And start getting all sloppy fucking drunk.
Yeah, I had a guy that, if you shut your eyes, you thought it was Stevie Ray Vaughan in the first and second set. But by the third set, I go, what's that? You just invented the key of X. Because I have never heard nothing like that.
Dude,
he's getting so mad, but it was
the key of X.
Oh, it was horrible. It was totally. They couldn't remember the lyrics of a song they sang for 8 months straight.
Yeah.
At gigs, you know? It was incredible. They got that wasted. But most of the bars we played at and parties, everybody was so wasted by the third set. A couple of times, I would just stop playing because he was too gone to continue.
Yeah.
One night, I shut down. Like, we're supposed to always play at least 2:30 at the bar. It was like 1 o'clock. And I walked out, threw my shit. Only the drummer and Randy knew I was pissed off because he's playing the key of X.
Yeah.
Like three songs in a row instead of maybe two and actually do something that sounded like music.
Yeah.
He was so wasted. And everybody else was too in the bar, but I wasn't. And neither was old Jocko Slice, the drummer.
Yeah.
John Corin. And I just walked out and went home, and then the next day I came back, and Jocko goes, nobody even noticed you left early. Everybody was so drunk.
God.
They were like,
how silent does it get when the bass player stops playing? You know what I mean? Like,
oh, yeah, they had to stop. We're a three-piece band.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. Like,
as soon as I locked up, it was over. Jocko stopped playing. He knew, and I went click.
Yeah.
Plus, I had to do almost all the singing of their set because they were too drunk to remember any vocals.
Dude, what was the band that
too much? So much fucking cocaine they couldn't talk.
What was the band that y'all played at Keffy's? Y'all played that?
Oh yeah, no,
man, dude. Oh, that was awesome. Everybody came down. All the boys from Jacksonville came down.
Yeah, it was great, man.
You had a couple songs that you sang.
Yeah, it was. I'll just tell you what Dion, the drummer, said about it after it ended right after that, of course.
Yeah,
I never seen so many dysfunctional people in my life, including myself, but we're so talented playing. He said, this is the best band I've ever been in that never was. You heard it, and it wasn't bad at all, man.
No, dude, it was awesome.
Sean was so freaking good on every instrument in the band. He could play better than any one of us. He'll come over and take an instrument, and I'll play you. I'll guarantee you. Bass, drums, but his head was so freaking huge. That double wide didn't hold it too much.
Yeah.
But he, you know, he's an All-American Indian.
Was he?
Yeah.
No shit.
That's what took him out. Just like the same thing. He was the best guitar player I ever played with, talented-wise.
Yeah.
Until about, on a good Sunday rehearsal, we'd start at 1. By, I'd say, 4 o'clock, when he hit the brown water.
Oh, no.
Over.
Yeah.
The beer, the pain pills. Yeah, okay. Didn't turn that around, you know. You can compensate. But once he hit the brown water, just like in the movies, man.
Yeah.
I mean, he was. I had to throw it back at him because he always called Thanksgiving was, stick an Indian in the back day, you know. And I said, yeah, you're right, you know, really.
Yeah.
Because we did the European trash, you know, we came over and just fucked them up. Took everything. Yeah. Took everything. Starved them. Killed them.
That is like.
It's pretty much what the robots are going to do to us.
Yeah.
We did to them. Already did to the Indians. Yeah. You know? It's not like they have to figure this out.
You know, and that,
alien. I mean, the super intelligence. They just look at our history and goes, "Oh, look! Look how easy it is.
Yeah.
To eradicate millions of people.
Right.
They do it all the time. They have a purge. Anarchy, the purge, fuck, we've been doing it for hundreds, thousands of years in war since the beginning. Right? Probably the soonest some people in caves found out where some other people in caves lived, that probably was the first conflict, right?
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to keep going that way until they say you can't go that way no more.
Well, we're instinctively tribal.
Or you breed in. They probably were smarter back in the old days.
Well,
old
something
days.
Had to happen. They just
interbred. Then you're a bigger clan. You're a bigger clan, you know, you got more shit going for you.
And then you have a fucking army.
Well, then that's what started the problem. Or these guys say, hey, man, we'll control what you fuckers do because we have an army and you don't. And now we're going to build a fucking castle. Once you build a fucking castle, subrogation is coming to town, baby. The serfs are going to take care of everything, all the hard work. Right?
Yeah. No, I mean, it's so true.
Yeah.
That is, and that's...
I mean, just like the Barons and the Clippers and... what's that show, man? It's just almost Sonny. The samurai guy, the samurai Clipper, the kill... They work for In the Future. Into the Badlands.
No, I don't know. Is
awesome.
That good?
Oh, man, yeah.
Is it on...
It's on, like, AMC and channels like where The Preacher... Do you ever watch The Preacher? That cult classic with his buddy Cassidy. Ruth Negger is the hit girl.
Yeah.
Oh, you are missing some of the best TV that's ever been on right now. you got to watch The Preacher. Seth Rogen and those other two guys. It's from like an old cult classic comic books. Like they get everything good from, I think.
Yeah.
But Preacher, it's on right now. Of course, I love, like, Vikings, you know, they get close. Of course, they mix the names and some of the history around. But basically, they show you how the shit was going down back then. That's why I like it. I like stuff that's almost like, it could have happened that way.
Yeah.
Sometimes if you squint your eyes a little bit, it could have looked like
it's
that.
It's entertaining with a historic twist to it.
Like, exactly. When you see Ragnar do the Blood Eagle on his enemy the first time, right? Then later on, the king, after they kill him, the king of Northumbria, King Aella, then they get him with a blood eagle. When they show that on TV, you know it's heavy shit, man.
I don't even know what the fuck that is.
Blood Eagle. You got to see a Blood Eagle done on the Vikings episode. You really appreciate it. I can't even describe to you how horrible.
Eagle.
Yeah, this is why they would like tie you up alive, of course. Once you really piss them off and you really, like, kill their king, you know, and throw him in a snake pit and then, you know, and bury his body. And they shouldn't have done that, right? Because he's got, like, sons and illegitimate sons all over frickin' the place.
Yeah.
Because he's a Viking,
right?
Well, anyway, I kind of mix the names up. But anyhow, this did happen with the Blood Eagle on King Aella. They stake you up, hold you out like that. Then he comes up behind you and cuts right down your spine.
Oh my God.
Right? Chops all the ribs out on each side with the Viking axe. And then they pull your lungs out and flip them up over your shoulders too. And then they spread your wings out. That's what they call it, the Blood Eagle too. They open up your side so when you're tied up like this and you're spread out, it looks like you got wings, and it does. They show it pretty thoroughly. And then, of course, you die pretty much. And then, before you die, they usually have archery contests to see how many arrows they can put in you before you die. They do that, too. Got nothing on the Apache, right? I mean, everybody was brutal in them days. Look, even the Roman, the church.
Yeah,
the Catholic Church, they're probably more deadly and ruthless than anybody.
Yeah.
The torture they would inflict on you before they burnt you alive.
You're the Blood Eagle.
The Blood Eagle, that is. Twice they show it.
Three shades of black is where I come from. depression, misery, and hellacious fun. No, we're not the kind to turn our backs and run. 'Cause three shades black is where we come from. We are a certain breed and we don't like you. Some are junkies, some are freaks, and others are everyday ghouls. No one will ever know what we've been through, and we are proud in the light of the moon. Three shades of black. The darkness gives us our thrills. Shades of black is where I come from. I was born into sacrifice when I was young. Three shades of black is what makes us strong, and we all wear it like a uniform of chosen ones. Three shades of black. Three shades of black. Three shades of black. We all like metal and whiskey, living hard and chasing downhill. We'll never give up on what we have, 'cause the darkness gives us our thrills. 'Cause the darkness gives us our thrills.
Are you from Cleveland? Is that where you're from? I was born in Akron, which is just south of Cleveland. It used to be the rubber capital of the world.
The what?
The rubber capital of the world. One time, that's where they made all the tires before Cooper and Shinseng and all those Japanese and Koreans and
yeah,
all those tire companies came over. All the tires. B.F. Goodrich was there. Goodyear was there. Firestone was there. And all my grandparents on my mom's side worked at those factories
back
in the 40s, 50s, you know, all that through. Before the war, after the war, until they closed them down. They retired out before they were closed down, but Firestone funding. My grandma worked at Firestone, and my grandpa worked at B.F. Goodrich when they came over.
Yeah.
Up there to work. That's where all the industry was.
And it's all gone.
They're like
now.
Cities. They're still there, a lot of the buildings, because like years later, I got an asbestos job. And guess what it was for? The B.F. Goodrich plant down there, we were taking all the asbestos out of all those plants. And let me tell you something. There is miles of underground tunnels where you drive these little Cushman carts through and shit. Maybe a small pickup truck. And then there are five-story buildings. There's pipes everywhere up to top. And then anywhere you have boilers and hot water. Everything was wrapped in asbestos. I mean, everything. And we took aerosol, horse hair, every kind of asbestos ever made. The big giant valves with the wheels on them, and the chase runs and all those tunnels apply all their wires. Everything's wrapped in asbestos for insulation. And it took us 9 months. We had a 9-month job taking all the asbestos out of there. And they were going to convert it to like a roller skating skateboard park in the tunnels, which I thought was an excellent idea, because there was like a couple of miles of it under there. And it looped all the way around, and it'd go up and down a little bit.
Yeah.
It's all brick walls. It's awesome there. You couldn't jump up real high, though. But you could definitely fly through there. And then they were supposed to put buildings in it, because they're going to actually repurpose it.
Yeah.
This is back when I thought, that's a good idea, you know, because Akron is like a desolate, you know, it's like everywhere else there's industry up there. Those cool old industrial brick buildings, which I still love to this day.
Yeah.
You know, they're built back in the early 1900s. They're still there. They're still there. And some of them are falling down, some of them are reclaimed, but to repurpose those, man, there's the coolest thing. Yeah,
there's got to be a shit ton of them up there, too.
Oh, just ride down. Every time I go up, see my folks. Up in northeast Ohio there, which is north of Akron over in the corner out in the sticks.
Mm-hmm.
I passed right through Akron. You can still see a lot of them. As you go right up there and through Canton, before you get to Canton, you know, the Hall of Football Hall of Fame.
Scott was just up in
Canton's
Cleveland
right outside
last
of Akron. Home of LeBron James. Yeah, Akron. Me and LeBron are homeboys. Macron. A.K. Ron, as a brother would say. Hey, I only lived there until I was only a little. I only remember it from seeing my grandma going to see her, because we moved out to the fucking horse farm. Then it was a work camp. The work camp scene came in for me.
The work camp.
Yeah, at about 6 years old, my little vacation was over. Living by the shore of Lake Erie, you know, going hunting. Going out in the boat in Lake Erie. All that shit was over by the time I was like six. We moved right to the little kid death camp. Fucking farm, horse farm, / everything, trying to survive farm, you know. You got to can your own food, grow your own, you know, slaughter your own pigs, beef, everything to survive. That's how it was at first. And then he got it going. Then it got better and better after that. But the early days, I remember that.
What do you mean? Why?
It was better being a pioneer.
Start getting people to work for it? Or work?
All of us kids.
Yeah.
Now, I had five sisters and a brother, man. My sisters could work like a man, you know.
Yeah.
But you were the ones that did all the maintenance. And he worked there at night of a Lincoln Electric Welding Company. He worked on the assembly line there for like 20 years. I give him respect, though. He wanted to retire like a year early because he had a deal to go to Arizona, take some of his race horses, and they says, "No, you're going to lose your pension." And he went, "Fuck you," and he laughed.
Holy shit.
Yeah, I helped him move out there. Took like three of his race horses and sold the farm, and sold everything. We had a killer 101 acre farm out there.
Yeah.
He's still Ohio, right, man? Prime. Like most of it, you know, they had like 20 in open fields and pastures for horses, but everything else is like not timbered wood.
Yeah.
Fucking beautiful, man.
I bet.
Beautiful way to grow up. But most time he wasn't there, only on the weekends.
Yeah.
You know, it was like Tojo came to town when the old man wakes you up on Saturday morning. Because all week he won't buy it. He didn't get home until like 2 in the morning.
Yeah.
And pretty much, unless it was a heinous crime against the family, he made you wait until Saturday, and then you went. It was like going to captain's mast in the Navy.
Oh, God.
Yeah, it waited, and then, boom, you're on trial. But you had no legal representation, of course.
No.
Because no matter what you said, he goes, "You're lying, pow!" Done. Judgment has been rendered. It's like Judge Dredd. The first Judge Dredd in my life was my old man. Right there. It was fucking weird for you. Man, where the hell did we go with this conversation?
I don't know.
The things I've seen, Wes.
Yeah. I like them, though. I like those stories. One of my favorites is the sliding across the county line. I'm gonna fuck the story up because it's not my story. It's yours.
That's happened several times on old Harleys.
Yeah.
Out around them.
You slid across the county line being chased by the cops.
Oh, yeah, that's in Colorado.
I think that was a neck bearing issue, was it not?
Yeah. First thing I learned about buying a chopper. first thing I ever learned was a critical suspension. Suspension. Well, it's something you wouldn't expect, you know, because the bike looked pretty good other than that. You know, but you don't know until the first time you hit it.
What was it?
It had no bottom neck cup bearing.
No, what was the bike?
60 pan.
Yeah.
It had a 9, listen to this though, it had a 9 over Indian leaf springer front end on it. It was chrome.
Yeah.
It was out there. It was out there. It looked pretty cool. It had a big gooseneck frame on it. It was definitely early 70s.
It had no bottom bearing?
No. He forgot to put it in, obviously. Probably. No, I mean, the cup was in the frame. I mean, but there's no bearing.
Yeah.
Race was in there. First time I hit 35, it shook a little bit. First time I rode it.
Yeah.
It shook a little bit. And then that's when the cops start chasing me. Because I was just doing a test ride around my neighborhood. And I just tried to get it back. But unfortunately, yeah. When you evade high-speed pursuit and you hit 65 with no neck bearing, it goes into a severe death wobble. And it did. I never felt nothing like this before. There's no way you can control it. That first swerve, I mean, it was like a lock-to-lock swerve three times. Boom, boom, boom. And then the third one I was doing, I was on my back sliding, watching the bike in front of me slide.
Fuck.
And it was going it weighed a little more than I did, so it was, thank God, it was like a 3 or 4 feet in front of me the whole time. The cop said I'll have to patch a blue from my blue jeans for 60 feet before I hit the median. They thought it was cool, the local cops. They were actually good guys. They put an army blanket on me, and people, is he dead? The women, is he dead? They go, go on, lady, go on. Get out of here. I remember, I could hear it. I just didn't have any wind in me at first. I was trying to breathe first. But
yeah.
They go, you okay? And I'm shaking my head, yeah. And I go, I remember everything on I had was saving me, except I didn't have gloves on.
Oh, damn.
I had a leather jacket, harness boot, burnt the buckles, burnt the seam. It did burnt right down to my skin, but them blue jeans took the seams right off.
Yeah.
Just in that 60 feet at 60 miles an hour. That's what they thought was a cool thing. But unfortunately, they were just going to, you know, unfortunately, the high patrol pulls up. Yeah. Right after I get my, like, 3 or 4 or 5 tickets from the locals. Hell, they didn't even, they were going to let me just go home because I refused medical treatment, you know, but the ambulance stopped anyhow just because they wanted to see what happened. That's what they said. We were in the neighborhood, man. You sure you just want to clean that up?
Yeah.
I go, no, I'm okay. Which I should have done. Then the high patrol dude comes up right out of the cowboy movies, man. Oh, shit. The guy you see in Vanishing Point, the original. You know, I go, oh, fuck. And here he comes. He starts right tickets and he impounded him. I try to scrape the paint and see the numbers. I go, no, I don't. You know, it's a hardtail Harley frame. They don't have the neck numbers, but I'll give him this. He did call the Harley shop, and the Harley guy sold me out because he goes, yeah, they're supposed to be in the rights. As soon as I heard him say it over his radio, I went, I am done, because this thing was all Bondo, just been, it was a root beer pearlescent brown, molded neck, you know. Yeah, it was.
Oh, man, that's pretty cool.
Paint job was all new. That's why I didn't expect the bearing not to be in there when he put the front end on.
Yeah.
But it wasn't. After that, of course, you know, I took it apart and got my wide glide. I went and sold that, got a wide glide. I did the shit, got all the parts. That's why I said, I'm going to start working on my own bikes from now on.
Yeah.
I didn't trust my life to anybody doing that. I started learning. But, man, death wobble. Woo. I was lucky. I did have to leave. I did have to leave the city after I went to court for that.
Why? They made you leave the city?
Oh, yeah. The judge threw the book at me. You know, when you see, like, every girl with a miniskirt, he's smiling, they're flirting back and forth. Everybody gets out of everything until I get up there. And he goes, when you saw that eluding, that's the one you never want to get out there. He goes, I consider that the only second worst of man vehicular manslaughter. And I went, oh, man. Because he's, like, nice to everybody until I got there. And he just, like, went, I'll tell you what, you had a job, I'm not going to put you in jail right now for this, but there's a mandatory sentence. He goes, if I see you in my court system in the next 120 days, something like that, he said, next 3 months, whatever, 6 months, I'm going to get you for this and anything else I can think of. And I went, yes, Your Honor, thank you, Your Honor. And I got out of there and I moved. That's why it was like in Thornton. I moved to Denver.
You were exiled.
Yeah, I had to move out of the county. Because if I got, I didn't ever want to go back here. Yeah, I got pulled over for anything. He said he was, you know, enact full fury on me then, because then he knew I was just trouble.
Oh,
when
God.
He saw that, it was stupid. I don't even know why he did it. I could have just pulled over, because the guy pulled up next to me, and I knew, I know it's Chuck, you know, and I went, I just wanted to see, and I said, well, I just got, I live that way. I'm going to go right back and park it, because I didn't want to get it impounded. Now I got like 18 tickets. My bike does get impounded, and it knocked the old SU carburetor right off of it, too, by the way. Snapped the manifold off.
Damn.
Did some scrapage on it, and then I had to prove to the highway patrol, using the first D&D Jammer handbook ever published, they saved me, that shows that that frame did not have frame numbers on it, so therefore they have to release it to me because I have the title.
Yeah.
And the guy actually agreed to it. And it talked to like a lieutenant commander,
you
making a point.
They're trying to show it to
him? It's like going to a military base. Yeah, lieutenant commander, high patrol, we'll see you now. Yeah, I had to wait 2 weeks to make an appointment to talk to him. I showed him the handbook. Yeah, I had it there.
Yeah.
And nobody else had any defense against it. And I was right, you know?
Yeah.
They didn't put them on rigid frames. Talk to him in the early 60s, man. But, yeah, he finally, I had to push it all the way home. Suffer insults from everybody that passed me. My buddy drops me off. He's, like, he's following me. Everybody's going, hey, I'll give you $50 for it.
Oh, my God.
Oh, yeah. Like, I had to suffer through all the embarrassment pushing it. They had no idea what I went through. They thought I just, the whole Harley broke down. Just give me the old shit, you know?
Yeah.
Throw litter at me and stuff. And I'm Jesus. Pushing this on the side of the road.
Chopper trash, man.
Yeah. They were lucky they didn't stop because my buddy with me, we were working construction. We could hold our own.
Yeah.
And he was, you know, he was no freaking pushover dude, man. He would have rolled with him. He was a tough old dude, and he was following me. See, they didn't know that. If they would have messed with me, they didn't know he was like following me real slow and driving my old 58 Ford Galaxy following me down the road up the slow strip, you know, all the way, man. I had to listen to it. Girls laugh and everything again. And then, you know what? I just kept maybe pushing a little bit harder because I knew I'd bring it back.
How far? How far did you have to push it?
Probably about 5-6 miles.
Fuck.
Yeah, it was not easy, man. I had no money for a tow truck.
Oh, my God.
Like I said, I had a 58 Ford Galaxy with a bad timing chain on it, you know, but it would run. That's how I got to work. I put everything in that pan and then that happened right away, so I had to get it back, then put another front end on it and get this thing up again, because then I rode it back from Colorado to Ohio, which it made it all the way to, I finally broke a chain outside of Cleveland before I finally ran out of money. I met some cool people on the road on that trip too.
Where, from Colorado to Cleveland?
Oh yeah, man. I met a guy from Cali, you know, going to Laconia. I'd ran into one of them, an old mechanic on the case. They're just great people. You just meet them, like, we just start riding together because, you know, I haven't seen anybody else out there.
Yeah.
Then some place there comes these old Cali, these California hippie surfer biker kind of guys, like chopped out Ducatis and stuff.
Yeah.
Not really Harley guys, but they were cool, you know, and they would ride with us for a while. They would think all the weed, all the ditch weed growing in Iowa or Nebraska was real, and they were stuffing it in their chest. We were laughing. I was like, did you get a good pot for that ditch weed? I said, that shit would just give you a headache. And they finally started taking it out.
Yeah.
I said, it's not worth it. Just go to any truck stop, it's sitting right in a glass of water right up on the counter. The cashier, I told him, I said, that shit will not get you high, I'm telling you.
What was it?
It's that wild marijuana that goes everywhere out there.
Oh, I don't think I've ever seen it.
Yeah, on the right off the interstate when you're going through Nebraska, Iowa, and the
summer. Just like getting the leaves and trying to smoke the leaves of it.
Yeah, we had stopped just to drain a vein on the side of the freeway. You know, you get out there in Nebraska and shit in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah,
but that shit just goes wild everywhere.
Okay,
when they used to grow it for rope, not.
Yeah, it's like it's a hemp. It's not a.
It's hemp. Yeah,
it doesn't have the.
But
THC.
It does. No, it doesn't. But it looks like a. You know, it looks like marijuana.
Yeah.
Immature, but these guys were stuffing it down your jacket the first time, but get rid of it. It's not going to get you high.
You got a gym.
They were cool, though, yeah. Met some great people, and like the. our great Motor City madmen over there. Anybody over in Michigan, met some great biker people there, helped us out. We thrown off the road for headlight being burnt out. We got to find somewhere to stay. And running to drunks, funny, running to some bikers, drunks, and took us out to get us drunk, let us stay at their place. These people are so cool that they took us out that night just because we were biker people. Had a great time, and we wake up in the morning, none of them were there, they all went to work, left a note, good to meet you guys, anything you want, help yourself, see you down the highway. That's the kind of people these were.
No shit.
Yeah, that's the things that you can't duplicate there, those kind of people. That's awesome. How the old creed, you know, that's how you help people out.
Yeah.
Pull over on the side of the road, whatever it took. Hi guys, I had guys stop when my battery blew up on one of my choppers in the middle of fucking nowhere. I mean nowhere. Take me to get my van to come back and get my chopper. But to guard it, he left this old lady there to guard my chopper. And she was so cool. I said, man, you don't have to do that. You know, you can't leave her out here in the middle of nowhere. She goes, she was reading some paperback. She goes, oh, as long as I got this book, I'm okay. She got a little blanket, her little towel, her hat, her shades, and went over the side. Yeah, we pushed it like off the road a little bit, you know. Yeah. But I mean, I was afraid even about it, maybe a bear or something would come up on our. That's how far out we were. And she goes, no, I'm good. I'm used to it. And that guy was so cool. People like that, you know, hard man.
Dude, that's awesome. Woo.
So I always went on the payback, you know, the biker way it was then.
Yeah.
I would pull over for guys like on the little Honda 350s and. Dream turn by, and they would get afraid at first, like they're used to getting shit from them all the time.
Yeah.
Because it went back and forth. But anyhow, they would like go, at first they would go, their eyes would get big, you know, they see you pull up on a 64 panhead, you know, and they're sitting on the side of the road, you know, they're no cell phones, you know, there's nothing around. And I go, hey, you okay? He goes, what? He was like, didn't know what to say. I said, you okay? I said, you need something? Oh, yeah. I said, my cousin stopped. I'm out of gas. He went to go get me some gas. Or they just said they had to get me the hell out of there. Yeah. I don't know, but at least they knew.
Yeah.
And I went, okay. I said, I always stop, man. I don't care what you ride. You know, it's not, you know, try to make it. No, we're out in the country. It wasn't so bad. Even though most of the time, when you went to a party out there, a kegger, pig cook-off, whatever it was, when you pull in, it will say, Harley parking sign with an arrow pointed straight ahead back towards the fire.
Yeah.
And it'll say Ricefield parking with an arrow going to the right out into the hayfield. Every time it was like that, though. It was like that for... It's not like the early civil rights for motorcyclists, like the blacks had to suffer through.
Yeah.
A lot more horribly than that, by the way. But I did see some guys get their bikes completely destroyed.
Yeah.
Lit on fire, whatever, you know, turned into toys. Over it. It could happen. Especially those bigger parties. I see that. Crazy. Oh, yeah. Well, being in a biker band, we play some killer biker parties like in Ohio, you know, like the big ones that are notorious up there for being, you know, 10 acres, 10,000 people.
Holy shit. Yeah.
Boom, everything, but a little bit of the action here and there. But just a good time, most of it. Just fun.
Hey, you know what? This weekend.
You had to know your shit.
This weekend is the beginning of Sturgis coming up.
Yeah. Let's go.
I know.
I put the bags.
Wait, you got
those not back, and there's a fixer right there. That's what I take.
Yeah.
I could never. It'd take me a month to ride this out.
Scott went to Cleveland last weekend.
Guessed I cheat at 66. Put it on a trailer for partway to go to Sturgis.
Do it. Well, y'all drove took the RV out there last time, didn't you?
Oh, man.
Have you seen...
Don't even tell me about that. The Zinc Odyssey to Sturgis. I'll tell you what, though. When you get out there...
Yeah.
And you ride your 200 miles a day, it's worth having a camper and everything already. You know, you already have a place to pull in and camp out, and it's got everything.
Have you seen me and Scott's Winnebago that we bought?
Hell no.
Dude. We had a 69 Winnebago.
69?
69 Winnebago Brave. Let me find a photo of this thing.
One of them survived the 60s.
Yeah, we just put a new motor in it.
I say Pace Arrow.
Would you say the Pace Arrow?
I thought you were going to say him. No. Pace Arrow version of Winnie. Winnie Bob. Remember my friends were bringing back bales of weed from Mexico and those Winnie Bobs. I'm parked by the dairy barn. Oh, man.
Do you have a Wi-Fi on here?
No.
No?
You can get them. No, I don't have them. There's somebody local over here that has it. Maybe you can try to get onto it, but I don't even try. I had to switch to get on like a better tower just to get internet out here on my phone.
Oh yeah, who did you have? Sprint?
Yeah,
that's what I've got.
Oh, forget it.
Yeah,
you're done. Verizon towers, the straight talk, man. It came at Walmart.
Yeah.
Half the price, same shit, half the price.
And you've got coverage.
And you're on the Verizon, which are prevalent out here. And now, if you go into Wallace, like 2 miles, your phone will work fine there.
Yeah.
That'll work perfect.
It's just out here.
Yeah, it's out here in the little dead zone. Now and then you can get some shit, but.
Because you're going to freak out when you're listening up. I've got
it's like trying to pick up Mars.
It's in my regular.
One of my new buildings I discovered on Mars this week. Oh, wait, I'll look at my space.com app.
All right, we're breaking this thing up into two parts. The Fizzle can go. He can talk. So, next Tuesday, we'll finish up with part two of The Fizzle. And until then, we'll see you guys on Friday.
I'm going to California where they sleep out every night. I'm leaving you, mama, 'cause you know you don't treat me right. Let me tell you something, mama, that you don't know. Let me tell you something, good gal, that you don't know. Well, I'm a do-right papa and got a home everywhere I go. Yeah, I got the California blues and I'm sure gonna leave you here. Lord, Lord, I got the California blues and I'm sure gonna leave you here. I may ride the blind, I ain't got no railroad fare. Listen to me, mama, while I sing this song. Listen to your daddy sing you this lonesome song. You got me worried now, but I won't be worried long. I got the California blues and I'm sure gonna leave. Hey, 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 I got the California blues.